is can you still with us, Dr. Krieger, in case yeah, some questions?
Yeah, I think so. I can hear you.
Okay, good. So anybody, any questions? Okay, yes.
Hi, I'm Raquel Jeffers, and I'm from the Nicholson Foundation, which is a foundation in New Jersey. And we very much are concerned with anything that we fund that there's an avenue for sustainability. And so I have a very technical question, and at the risk of it being a very basic or stupid question, please bear with me. There's no stupid question, right? Because I feel like I'm hearing two different things. If a community health worker is not in a state plan for Medicaid, can a health plan pay for a community health worker anyway?
Based on New York State, they are not being recognized to be able to build, even though if in the event that they also hold the credential of asthma educator certified.
No, I understand that the Medicaid agency in a state might not have authorized or approved a community health worker as a Medicaid-approved provider. My question is, if you're in a managed care environment, which is the case in New Jersey, where almost 97-98% managed care, can a health plan choose to reimburse for community health workers as like an in lieu of service? Is that an allowable reimbursement?
That would be great. Yes, please. That's actually our goal.
It's a complicated...
This is Jim from Seattle. One option that we have explored and is feasible, at least in Washington State, is having specific contracts between the local health department and managed care plans, where managed care plans actually pay the health department for providing community health worker home visits to managed care plan enrollees, and it doesn't go through a Medicaid reimbursement mechanism. It's an independent contract that the health plans have with the local health department.
Okay, for the here and now is how business has been done prior to DSRIP, and I'm hoping and praying that this changes the whole game. A health plan can do it. The only problem as a health plan is that the way that we get our premiums from the state is that you got two sets of buckets for expenses. One are administrative costs, and that's pretty well ratcheted down, and then you got the medical expense. If I can have something fall into the medical expense, so if a community health worker services were billable to Medicaid, that's cool, and that's then recognized in any sort of savings or then be part and parcel of that. If I, as the health plan, use my administrative dollars, okay, the premium, well, I'm paying extra for that, and I have to, I'll live and die with that. But if I have any savings out of the medical bucket, the next go around, I'm going to be rewarded wonderfully by having my premium drop down. So the way that the accounting goes and all that's got to be looked at. So this is where, through DSRIP, if you're doing bundled payments and the like, there's the opportunity to reconfigure how reimbursement is being performed, and I think that's the way to do it. But with the current methodology, it's very difficult for a health plan on the long term to keep pushing this because you get rewarded by getting your rates whacked. Okay, that's the way that it goes. So, right? I mean, yeah. So we can do it, and we do it because it's the right thing, but I have to be careful because, well, what works for me is it's done regionally. So if I'm the only plan that's doing it, it could be pretty good because everybody else is still driving up costs and all that, and I'm doing the right thing, and then my costs go down, so it's wonderful. But if everybody does it all together, the reimbursement's all going to go down, and if it sits within the administrative bucket, you're not going to get the return on it that way. It's all a financial conversation. This is why we got to talk to one another. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
In a bundled payment environment, how would it work?
I don't know, because we're about to embark on that wonderful adventure. But I think theoretically, if you think about it, it's going to depend upon how funds get allocated, and then you get back to this term braiding. Okay, so what can you do with various funding sources, and if you're going to get into social impact bonds, that's a wonderful thing, but then really the devil's in the details in terms of how you can make it work so everybody's got a win-win situation. And I think that's the major thing that we have to do. So we're going to be learning on this, and I know that Doug's going to be taking the lead on it here, like for us here for New York State. I hate putting the weight on your shoulders, but the thing is, that's where it's exciting times to be able to do stuff, and I think we got to be working together on it in terms of, okay, how do we make the programs like what we've heard about here just now viable, vibrant, and do the things that they do well, and then not have losers in this whole equation because of the way the finances are being set up. I think we can do it, and it's possible.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. And I can imagine how the Department of Health in here probably feeling everybody just looking at them and seeing that we hope to see that as part of this trip. I also please eager all of you to start tweeting that is creating that advocacy, that it is really a need. We need to take action, and this is the perfect venue. I echo what Amisha keeps saying. We have to keep this momentum, so this great conversation that we are having. Any other question we allow for? Thank you so much.